I have all joined. Am I audible?
Only yeah, audible. Two learners are joined till now. We would wait or start.
Are they expected? Have you contacted them?
Actually,
We can start
I
or
think
otherwise.
okay. Welcome, dear learners. In the previous session, we discussed about block 3, unit 1 and unit 2, that is public trends in public expenditure and public revenue, and about budget statement. And in the previous session, I communicate all the learners, those who are present at that session, that the next session is the continuing part of that one. And in the next, the rest 3 units will be discussed. So in today's session, we will discuss about block 3 again, but the rest 3 units, such as Indian tax system, fiscal policy and its implications. As in the previous session, it was discussed, the budget is the financial statement that represents the all the sources of revenue and all the expenditures that are planned for future. Again, we discussed in the previous session that the sources of revenue, classification of sources of revenue, and from that we know that tax revenue constitute a major portion of revenue. So, to pursue any kind of public project, government need a huge amount of revenue. That's why to know the significance and to know about the Indian tax structure is very much important from this point. And we all know that Indian Constitution has made a provision for federal tax structure. So here the term federal tax structure, it means what? It means the Constitution made a provision for division of power for levying taxes between the center and the state. So this is the tax structure. Again, to maintain economic and social stability, fiscal policy playing an important role. Fiscal policy means it is concerned with the determination of state income and expenditure policy. So in this today's session, our resource person will discuss about all these topics. So for that, without wasting a minute, I welcome our resource person, Dr. Ashish Das sir, and he is an academic consultant at Odisha State Open University. So he will discuss all the matters relating to tax, fiscal policy, and its policy implications. So I request Ashish sir to start the session.
Welcome, dear learners. So you have got already some basic exposure to the tax structure and what are the different types of revenue. So today we'll be discussing basically about to start with the Indian tax system, then the deficits and its implications, and the third one is basically the fiscal policy and what are its objectives. To start with, if you are looking at the tax system or the Indian tax system, you know that India is a federal state or quasi-federal state. It has a union government and it has also a state government. Now, both the government has got certain powers to impose taxes on the citizens. Now, because both of them have powers, they cannot put or impose taxes on the same item. So there is a clear-cut constitutional division of the items on which the central government has jurisdictions, on which the state government has jurisdictions, and on which both center and state has jurisdiction. That means in this three-tier structure, the central government can impose taxes and then it can appropriate the tax it can consume. Central government can impose and then it can distribute the tax with the state government, share the tax, whatever it is. So there are certain items on which the tax has to be shared between the center and state. But there are certain items you have to have the state government imposing the tax, and then it can return than the entire text for its own purpose. So this is basically the text system. Now coming to the these three list, there is an union list item on which we have the union list item. The union government or the central government has complete jurisdictions. In the state listed item, the state government has jurisdictions, and the concurrent list item, the jurisdictions are under the both the government. But wherever there is conflict between the center and the state, the rule imposed by the central government prevails over the state government. Now coming to the tax structure, the tax on income, etc., comes income tax falls under the union government, but agricultural incomes are under the state government. Similarly, you have got excise duty tax, corporate tax, that is under the central government. In the state government, we have got land revenue, estate duty, tax on mineral, tax on lands and buildings. All these comes under the state government. Under the concurrent list, the tax on property and building, the earlier there used to be, now also this octroi tax is there, the entertainment tax, all these comes under the concurrent list. So there are income tax act, there are income tax, wealth tax, then gift tax, expenditure tax, interest tax, and various other types of taxes that is there. So this is basically the broad tax systems that is prevailing in our country. Now coming to understand this better, let me share this slide, my PowerPoint. 1 minute. Is this screen visible now?
No, sir.
Screen is not visible?
No, sir.
Now entire screen share. Is my screen visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, when you look at the key principles, particularly I'm talking about the budgets and its implications, the key principles are nobody spends somebody else's money as carefully as he spends his own. Is it correct? So when you are spending or dealing with others' money, you are not as careful as when you are dealing with your own money. So the difference is when the responsibility with which you spend the money. Government has nothing to give anybody except what it first takes from somebody. So on the one way, government is taking money from the people in the form of tax. You have already studied different types of taxes through which government is taking money. And the government also gives it back to the public through the public expenditure or through grants or subsidy. So in one hand, it is taking money from the public, and in other hand, it is giving the money back to the public. Now, in this, there has to be certain kinds of responsibility. That is called the legislative objective of fiscal responsibility and budget management. Now, to provide for the responsibility, then I was talking about when government is dealing with others' money, it has to be responsible for what it is spending, how it is spending, and what are its outcome. So there is a responsibility that is fixed on the government to provide for the responsibility of the central government to ensure intergenerational equity. Intergenerational means between two generations, there has to be certain kind of equity. You cannot consume too much. You cannot take lot of debt and then transfer the burden of the debt to the other generation. That means, jodi ei particular samayare आमे बहुत गुड़े लोन नहीं जीवा, ऋण नहीं जीवा, अब से ऋण आमको तो परे सुझीवा को पड़ीबो, तो ऋण सुझीवा पाई, परवर्ती समय रे, मे बी आउ 10 वर्ष 15 वर्ष किबा 25 30 50 वर्ष परे से ऋण भार का ऊपर पड़ीबो, द जनरेशन व्हिच हैज प्रोबेबली नॉट येट कम टू दिस अर्थ नाउ, सो दैट इज इंटरजेनरेशनल इक्विटी. सो द व्हेन द लोन इज टेकन, it has to be ensured that public it has to be ensured that the future generation is not heavily taxed. So to provide for the responsibility of the central government to ensure intergenerational equity in fiscal management and long term macroeconomic stability by achieving sufficient revenue surplus, the government has to achieve adequate revenue surplus by taxing and collecting revenue and removing fiscal impediments in the effective conduct of monetary policy and prudential debt management consistent with fiscal stability through limits of the central government's borrowing, debt and deficits. Okay, now the difference between debt and deficit is today what is deficits, the tomorrow it will become debt. The cumulative or accumulated deficits over a period of time is known as debt. So our public debt or the debt is a burden on the society. Later on, you have to, today you have taken 10 rupees loan, tomorrow you are taking another 20, next day another 30. So the cumulative, today we have a deficit, you are taking loan. And then to make up for the deficits. So you want to spend 20 rupees, you have 10 rupees in your pocket, you have taken loan of 10 rupees. So that 10 rupees is the deficit currently. Now with that 10 rupees, next year again you start, you have a deficit of 10. So you have taken the loan of again 10 rupees. So this 10 plus 10 will become 20. So the cumulative deficits over a period of time is going to be the debt. So central government needs to keep a track of these deficits and debt, and then with a greater transparency in fiscal operations of the central government, conducting fiscal policy in the medium term framework, and also matters connected there with the incidental. So this is basically the responsibility that is entrusted upon the government. The government has to judiciously think of collecting revenue so that it is not running into too much of deficit. There is a deficit target that has been given. It cannot exceed certain deficit target. At the same time, it is also responsible for ensuring that the debt burden is not transferred to the future generation too much, so that it is a burden for them. And it has the responsibility to ensure intergenerational equity. Now, complexity, conflict, and interest and the moral hazards. Now, what I mean to say here is, citizen, any citizen, forget about things that is there in the books or any syllabus or everything. Coming to a simple citizen, what is that his interest or objective is? Any citizen would definitely like to get more from the government by paying less. That means government should give us, now people are expecting they should give us this subsidy, that subsidy, PDS, public distribution system, or they should. So what is that is received by the citizen, they would like it. So any citizens would like to get more from the government, and they would like to pay as less as possible. That is, the tax they have to pay should be as less as possible. On the same, at the same time, if you look at from the government point of view, how to give more to the citizens? Definitely, government wants to give more and more because it has certain kinds of what is that called, interest, vested interest in it. Because without spending, without doing some good to the public, they will not be able to come to power. So government wants to spend money. Government wants to give more and more to the citizens while at the same time taking more from them, and also balancing the special interest effects and short-sightedness effect. That is, special interest, special category people, they should be benefited through the public expenditure and tax system. Now, when you look at GDP as an indicator, your GDP is C plus I plus G plus X minus M that you have studied in the national income. Here, this G or the government expenditure comes as one of the key parameters. Now, GDP or gross domestic product indicates annual national wealth production or the value added at every stage of production of goods and services, which is basically computed by CSO or Central Statistical Organization, which comes out with advanced estimate, quick estimates, and quarterly estimates. That is known to us in our national income accounting. Now, coming to the growth, growth is nothing but the growth over the previous year in terms of GDP. That means it indicates how the rate of growth indicates how fast a nation is getting richer and richer. That means GDP of this year minus GDP of previous year divided by GDP of previous year will give you the growth over previous year. So that one of the basic objectives of any government is to ensure the growth. So this growth is the objective of the government, and it is possible through both monetary and fiscal policy. Now, how this growth is possible? What causes the growth? It is increase in the output or GDP. What causes increase in the output? That is increase in productivity or employment. If the productivity of the people, amar jo karjo karibar kousala, amar jo the productivity, that means for unit of labor, how much we are able to produce. Gote labor dwara ame kete output produce kori paruchu. So amar jo the productivity, labor productivity bodhila, amar jo the employment bodhila, that would cause increase in the output. Then what will cause the increase in productivity? That is increase in the efficiency. Now, how the efficiency or dakshata kemiti vruddhi paiba? The efficiency is a function of two things. One is the technology, second is in your skills. So you need to accumulate skills, and you should have effective technology for enhancing your efficiency. Now, what raises this investment and skills? That is creative people with money. If the people have creative capacity, they know how to invest and how to get profit, how to do business, and they have adequate money, then there is possibility of growth. Then how to do it? You have more people with creativity and help them to access money, maybe through your banking institutions and so. Now, look at the general government finances, that consist of Y equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Or the general government sector consists of central, state, and local government. We have a central government, as you have discussed, and the social security funds controlled by these units. So the government sector consists of both central government, that is union government, the state government, and the local self-government like your Panchayati Raj institutions. Now, we have already discussed about the structure, that is union list, state list, and concurrent list. And coming to the objective of the fiscal policy, the basic objective of fiscal policy is to mobilize resources for sustainable economic growth and to achieve the target of full employment. I will come back to the deficit part again, but before coming to deficit, let us understand what are the basic broad objectives of our fiscal policy, because all this expenditure as well as the taxation that leads to our deficits is a part of fiscal policy. Then the broad objective of fiscal policy is to mobilize resources for sustainable economic growth and to achieve the target of full employment, that is at any point of time our growth should be sustainable, the economy should have full employment, there should not be unemployed people too much, and then to restrain the price instability in order to ensure economic stability. That means price instability means there should not be too much of inflation or too much of deflation. Mild inflation may be good for the economy, however, that you should not, the inflation or deflation or the price instability should not be beyond the control. It should be monitored and within our control, and to achieve equitable distribution of income and wealth. That means our income and wealth in the society should be equitably distributed across citizens. Of course, there will be inequality. However, government always attempts to reduce the gap between the rich and the poor through tax and transfer mechanism. There is a mechanism through which the government is taxing people with higher income and giving subsidies to people who are with lower income. So what is happening in the sense, the income of the richer people is getting transferred to the poorer people through tax and subsidy mechanism. That is one attempt, one such attempt by the government to redistribute the income and wealth in the society in order to ensure equitable distributions between them. Now, when we are looking at the expenditure analysis and cause and effect, a higher economic GDP growth yields a higher tax revenue. Suppose your GDP growth is very high, your GDP is high, because tax is basically a fraction of your income, particularly income tax or anything. If the economic activity grows, the tax revenue will automatically grow. The higher tax revenue yields greater fiscal flexibility. Now, if you have more tax revenue, the flexibility that is there with the union government, state government to spend the money they would like to in different types of expenditure or investment, they would be having more flexibility. They need not have to depend too much on borrowing and things like that for accomplishing the government's fundamental task. So tax revenue would be higher, or tax revenue would be higher if there is high GDP growth. A low level of debt liability increases the net worth of the government. So if you have more revenue, your dependability on the debt or ame kete udhar neba seta amara kami jibo. So low tax and what is that, less debt, higher tax and less debt is good for the economy. Now, coming to fiscal policy, it is basically refers to the policies pertaining to tax and government expenditure, including the transfer payments. One is the tax. Tax is the different types of tax we have already studied. And then the government expenditure we'll be talking about. Now, tax is basically the revenue side. There are other revenue, non-tax revenue as well. And then we have also the government expenditure and the transfer payment. So how the government is deciding these taxes and the government expenditure, and how it is transferring the money through subsidies is the basic or the crux of the fiscal policy. So the overall conduct of this policy plays a significant role in maintaining high employment and output, which is basically the objective of the economy or any economy. Now, how the growth can happen through fiscal policy is known as the expansionary fiscal policy. That is, by raising the public expenditure. When the government is government expenditure, you can recall we are talking about the income y equal to c plus I plus g plus x minus n, and then when g is increasing, your total income is also increasing, government expenditure. And then if the tax rate is reducing, your disposable income increases, and therefore your total income also increases. This we have already discussed earlier. So what is a good tax structure? Revenue yield should be adequate. Distribution of tax burden should be equitable. A good tax structure means it should be able to earn good revenue, and it should be adequate, and it should be equitable. Intent to achieve stabilization and growth objectives that we have discussed, and low administrative and compliance cost. We should not be spending too much money to collect the tax. This tax structure or rate are basically progressive, regressive, and proportional. That means progressive tax means as the income increases, you are paying higher and higher amount of tax. For example, up to 1 lakh, there is no tax. Up to maybe 4 lakhs rupees, you need not have to pay any tax. From 4 lakhs to 10 lakhs, you have to pay, for example, 10% tax. 10 lakhs and above, you have to pay. 10 lakhs to 15 lakhs, you have to pay 20%. 15 lakhs and above annual income, you have to pay 30%. That means as your income is increasing, your tax rate is also increasing, which is known as progressive tax. Suppose the tax rate does not increase, it is 10% flat, then we are talking about a proportional tax system. Regressive tax means, which is not used basically, but then theoretically, regressive tax is as your income is increasing, less percentage is being taxed. Now, coming to our budget and the deficit, the overall picture of the financial performance of a government during the period since its last budget is basically captured in the budget, and the government finances. Government's financial plans for the period up to the next budget. These are the two major content. That is the overall picture of the financial performance of the government during the period since the last budget. So if the budget is presented February 1st of 2020-2021 or 2019-20, that would be there in the part of the budget, and then how it has performed in the previous year, and how it is going to plan for the next year. That is the cross of the budget. Now, if you look at the stages of budget, there are so many stages: review of the mission statement and objective, review of previous year's performance. This is just for information. Don't take it very seriously. Just an information item here. And the government on the agreement on activities, linking activities to source of funds, prioritizing activity to fit within budget ceiling, sectoral budget, hiring, revision of plan and estimates, parliamentary subcommittee hearing, parliamentary approval of the bill, implementation, monitoring, valuation, audit, and regulation. Now, this is essential. Now, all that is there, you have already studied, is Consolidated Funds of India. The money, what is this Consolidated Fund of India? The tax and all these things that comes to your tax revenue, non-tax revenue, grants, donations, market borrowings, your loan repayments, interest receipts, all these things comes to the Consolidated Fund of India here. And it is coming in from state governments, public sector units, other departments, citizens, all that They pay the taxes and it comes to the consolidated fund, and the government spends it. A government receives the revenue from these sources, and then it spends the money in terms of your revenue expenditure and capital expenditure. So earlier, railway budget used to be separate, but then now it is merged. Railway budget, though earlier it was separate, now it is merged. But then, despite that, both the cases, it is a part of the consolidated fund of India. These are the key budget documents. There are more than 13 documents that if you see, the key budget documents, that is the annual financial statement, budget at a glance, then budget speech, budget highlights, action taken on budget announcement, receipts budget, financial bills, FRBM statements, the explanatory memorandum, appropriation bill, demands for grants, and the detailed demand for grants. All these things are there as a budget document. If you go to this Ministry of Finance, that is the FinMin website, you'll be able to get on the budgets and economic survey. All these documents are available. Objectives pursued by the government through the budgets, basically activities to secure a reallocation of resources, redistribution activities, stabilizing activity, and management of public enterprise. These are the broad objectives of the budget that we will be discussing. Now coming to budget, the revenue receipts, capital receipts we have discussed. What is revenue receipts? We have got the tax revenue and non-tax revenue, that is revenue receipts. Recovery of loans, other receipts and borrowings and other liabilities, this is capital receipts. Then we have, if you include these two, both revenue receipts and capital receipts, that is item 1 and 2, then we are coming to the total receipts. So total receipt is basically the combination of your revenue receipts and capital receipts. This is essential to understand the deficit part. Now coming to budget, you have got revenue expenditure. Total expenditure is basically, this is the expenditure sides. You have got revenue expenditures, that is including your interest payments and grants in aid for creation of capital assets and your capital expenditure. Then in the budget, you will have the revenue deficits. Now coming to these deficits, it is essential to understand different theories. Like for example, this neoclassical theory, and you have got the Keynesian theory of this deficits. Now the neoclassical schools consider the deficit as budget deficit reaches the total lifetime consumption. It shifts the tax to the future generation and increasing the current consumption. Now when you are taking loan to finance the deficit, you take loan, and that loan is increasing current consumption and it is transferring the burden to the future generation. By assuming full employment of resources, the neoclassical school argues that, so in under neoclassical rules, there is a assumption of this full employment, and under that assumption, they argue that increased consumption implies a decrease in saving. So if your consumption is going up, your income is a sum of consumption plus saving. High consumption would mean lesser saving. The interest rate must then rise to bring equilibrium in the capital market. So when your saving is falling, then your interest rate will rise. The higher interest rate with the budget deficit would crowd out private investment. Now, what is crowding out? Because of increase in the interest rate, the private investment goes out. So when basically a private investor invests, keeping in mind what interest he has to pay. So in any increase in the interest rate crowds out private investment. So your growth will not be as much as what it would have been if the interest rate has to be managed or kept at the initial level. So, कौन हुए जदि हमरो interested टा बढ़ी गला, interested बढ़ी दिवा द्वारा private investment टा बाधा प्राप्त हुए, अब जति की मात्रा रे private investment आसीबा कथा, जदि interested 5% अछि, यदि हमरो deficit बढ़ी गला, डेफिसिट बढ़ीबा द्वारा इंटरेस्ट रेट बढ़ी गला काई ना हमर कंजम्पशन बढ़ी जाउची सेविंग कमी जाउची यदि हमर इंटरेस्ट रेट टा बढ़ी गला तो प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट जो जति की हे मात्रा रे हेबा कथा ता ही परिव नहीं ताटू कमी जीव ता तार प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट रो मात्रा टा कमी जीव तो एटा होची बेसिकली द आर्गुमेंट दैट इज बाय द न्यू क्लासिकल स्कूल्स ऑफ कोर्स देयर आर सर्टेन पॉलिसीज लाइक मॉनेटरी पॉलिसी कैन बी अकोमोडेटिंग टू कंट्रोल दैट इज monetary authority can increase the supply money to maintain the interest rate and then ensure that the crowding out is not happening. So there are some monetary measures. So alone fiscal policy cannot stop the crowding out effect. It has to take the help of monetary policy. Now coming to the Keynesian school, what they are talking about, the temporary tax reduction or increase in the government expenditure would increase aggregate demand. That means if there is a reduction in the tax, you are talking about disposable income will go up when there is a reduction in the tax. This increases the demand for money, this will increase the aggregate demand. As the resources are now not fully employed, national income rises due to the multiplier effect. So a reduction in the tax will lead to growth in the economy. This increases the demand for money, which increases the interest rate. The increase in interest rate would partially offset the multiplier effect. However, it would neutralize by the profitability of investment. The budget deficit have expansionary effect as it results in increase in production, which makes investor more optimistic in investment. So this leads to again crowding in effect. That means it will increase the investment in the economy. So these are some of the theories that is there. Then coming to the types of deficits, we have this revenue deficits. In the revenue deficit, there is nothing but, and then you have got fiscal deficit and primary deficit. The revenue deficit is the revenue expenditure minus the revenue receipts. Now, we have already seen what is revenue expenditure here. That is total tax revenue and total non-tax revenue. So when you deduct this revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts, we will get the revenue deficits. Similarly, the fiscal deficits is nothing but the total expenditure minus revenue receipts plus recoveries of loans and other receipts. Then if you look at the primary deficit, that is another concept, that is fiscal deficits minus the interest payment. This is the primary deficit. Now if you look at our budget documents, suppose pay attention to this. If this is basically the budget at a glance, I've taken from the budget document itself. Now, in this, you are seeing 3 years. 2018-19, the actual budgets, 19-20, you are seeing the budget estimates, then 1990-1920, you are seeing the revised estimate also, and the last column is talking about 2021, which is the budget estimate again. Okay, now budget estimate for the financial year 2021. Now, the revenue receipts has got two components here, tax revenue, net to center. Net to center means after giving the share to the state government. So state government, as I have already mentioned, has got a share in the central revenue. So once they transfer the share of the state governments, then the net tax revenue which arrived at. That amount is given. These all are in crores rupees. Then the non-tax revenue. Non-tax revenue is also given. Now, if you add this tax revenue and non-tax revenue, you will arrive at the revenue receipts in each of the case. Now, the capital receipts is basically the sum of item number 5, 6 and 7, that is recovery of loans, other receipts, borrowings and other liabilities. Similarly, the total receipts is 1 plus 4, that is revenue receipts and capital receipts. If you add this number, revenue receipts and then the capital receipts, you will arrive at the total receipt. Item number 1, that is revenue receipts, and item number 14, that is capital receipts. So this is the formula basically given here itself in the budget. Revenue receipts plus capital receipts, that is item 1 and 4, that is giving you the total receipt. That means if you add this this number, that is the capital, the revenue receipts number with that of the capital receipts number, you will get the total receipts in the economy. Now, total expenditure is the sum of item 10 and 12, that means expenditure on revenue accounts and 13 grants in aid. So this is the total expenditure. You need not have to explain, add the interest payment. Now, if you look at the total expenditure, how much money is paid in terms of rate of interest here? That is 582 million crores rupees are being paid. 582,000 crores rupees are being paid in terms of the interest payment. So this is because of, this is repayment of past loan. Then we have got capital account, item number 13. How much expenditure is there in the capital account? That is there. Then your revenue deficit is 10 minus 1. 10 is here our revenue account, that is revenue, total expenditure on revenue accounts. And if you recall, this item 1 is revenue receipts. Revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts is giving you the revenue deficit. Effective revenue deficit is again 14 minus 12, that is revenue deficits minus item number 12. That is grants in aid for creation of capital assets. So whatever grants in aids are given, that if you have to deduct, that is item number 12, then we will be able to arrive at effective revenue deficit. Similarly, fiscal deficits is nothing but your borrowings and other liabilities. Borrowings and other liabilities are your fiscal deficits. How this is arrived at? You can see here the fiscal deficits, which item number 9 minus 1 plus 5 plus 6. Item number 9 is our total expenditure minus 1 plus 5 plus 6. 1 plus 5 plus 6 is here. 1 is your revenue receipts. Then 5 is recovery of loan.
Hello, dear learners, please stay connected. I think due to some technical issues, there is a problem. Dear learners, please stay connected. Within few seconds, resource person will join.
ମ୍ୟାଡମ୍ କେତେବେଳୁ ଡିସକନେକ୍ଟ ହେଲା?
I think so 10 minutes ହେଲାଣି disconnected ହେଇଯାଇଛି।
10 minutes କୋଡ ପଢ଼ୁଥିଲି। ଆଚ୍ଛା ଆଉ ତ ଏଇଟା ଶେୟାର ଅପସନଟା ଆସୁନାହିଁ, ଶୁଣାଯାଉଛି ମୁଁ ଯାହା କହୁଛି?
Yes sir, audible.
Audible.
Audible, କିନ୍ତୁ presentation ଟା
ରୁହନ୍ତୁ। ମୁଁ ଆଉ ଥରେ ଇଏ କରିବାକୁ ପଡିବ, ଆଉ ଥରେ କନେକ୍ଟ କରୁଛି। ଇଣ୍ଟରନେଟଟା ସ୍ଲୋ ହେଇଯାଇଛି ନା? ସରି ଫର ଦ ଇନକନଭିନିଏନ୍ସ। ମ୍ୟାଡମ୍ ଶୁଣାଯାଉଛି?
Yes, sir.
ନା, ଏକ୍ଚୁଆଲି କୋଉ ପଏଣ୍ଟରେ ମୋର ଥିଲି ସେତେବେଳକୁ? প্রজেক্টটা দেখুতলে সব ডেটশিট দেখি পারলে
ইয়েস স্যার ইয়েস স্যার
আচ্ছা তো ওকে তো বেসিক্যালি আই ওয়াজ টকিং অ্যাবাউট দ্যাট ফ্যাক্ট দ্যাট দ্য প্রজেক্ট ইজ এ ভেরি লার্জ ডকুমেন্টস অ্যান্ড দ্য ডকুমেন্ট আর এক্সেল শীট দ্যাট আই ওয়াজ শোয়িং ইজ বেসিক্যালি এ স্মল কম্পোনেন্ট ইট ইজ প্রজেক্ট এট এ গ্লান্স অ্যান্ড This document shows budget basically shows the details of all the items of the government expenditure and all the sources of government revenue for a given financial year. Now the difference between the government receipts, whatever the government is receiving, the revenue, and the expenditure is basically the budget deficit. But for convenience purpose, we have classified into different types of.
Sir, voice is not audible, sir. Dear learners, please be stay connected. I think there is some network issue or something is there. That's why again and again our resource person is disconnected. Don't go away. Please be stay connected. Again, he will join again. So please be stay connected.
Screen share.
नो सर, स्क्रीन तो देखा जाऊंगी। वॉइस सर ऑडिबल?
ऑडिबल था?
यस सर।
बेसिकली what I was talking about that they take our the government budget deficit reduces national saving deficits माने हमर जो revenue और expenditure भीतर जो difference होने से हमर deficit यदि हमर deficit बेसी है हमको investment करना पड़ेगा तो investment का government saving का reduce हमको invest करना पड़ेगा government investment करना पड़ेगा मतलब investment कमी and then it will reduce the net exports and it creates a corresponding flow of assets abroad because we have to pay the interest to outsiders. The budget deficit is good or bad depends on how we are going to use the deficit or the loan that we are taking. So if it is used for productive purpose, then it may be good and then it will give us a capacity to get a loan in addition to earning some income out of it. But if the loan is taken for consumption purpose, or if the loan is taken for consumption purpose, there may not be a good impact on the economy. So depending on the receipts and expenditure of the government, there can be different types of deficits that can be taken into consideration that we have already discussed. Now the traditional measures of budget deficit and overall budget deficit, which is the difference between the total expenditure, which revenue expenditure and capital expenditure, and the total receipts, that is revenue and capital receipts, which is the our budget deficit. Then we will also discuss different concepts of monetized deficits or the revenue deficits, fiscal deficits, and primary deficit concepts. So. 1 minute. Let me share this screen. मैडम बेटा उनको कौन का देखो किस तरफ इस लाइन के हेलो
ये सर
मैडम इस लाइन पर देखो
Sir, actually, your voice is not clear. नहीं सर कौन सर प्रेजेंटेशन विषय देख मैंने पहुंचा रहे चंदी था नहीं सर नहीं सर देखा जाऊं नहीं
वॉइस भी सुना जाऊंगी
वॉइस सुना जाउछ बट सर सम डिस्टरबेंसेस इज देयर माने क्लियर हो नथला वॉइस टा एबे टिके टिके क्लियर हो जे
सम इंटरनेट इशू देखा जाउ स्क्रीन टा
नहीं सर स्क्रीन देखा जाउ नहीं
चेष्टा करियो
सर आई थिंक हाँ सर अभी सुना जाऊछे प्रेजेंटेशन टा बोधे देखा जाए पारे नहीं सर
सब प्रेजेंटेशन रूम में Can ask something. What is there in the time I connect? Was it which is entire screen? Share. Asking the screen.
No, sir.
ନା ଆପଣ ଟିକେ ସେଟା କମ୍ପ୍ଲିଟ୍ କରିବେ କି ନହେଲେ ସମରାଇଜ୍ କରିକି ବୋଧେ ଏପଟୁ କିଛି ଇଣ୍ଟରନେଟ୍ ଇସ୍ୟୁ ଅଛି ହେଇପାରୁନି
ନାଇଁ ସାର୍ ଭଏସ୍ ଅଡିବଲ୍ ହେଉଛି ଆପଣ ପ୍ରେଜେଣ୍ଟେସନ୍ଟା ମାନେ ପ୍ରେଜେଣ୍ଟ ହଉ ହଁ ଅଡିବଲ୍ ହେଉଛି ଆପଣ ଖାଲି କଣ୍ଟିନ୍ୟୁ ୱିଥ୍ ଦି ଟପିକ୍ ମାନେ ସେ ପ୍ରେଜେଣ୍ଟେସନ୍ଟା ନହେଲେ ନାଇଁ ପଛେ ଖାଲି ସାର୍ ଆପଣ କହିଦିଅନ୍ତୁ
depending on the risks and expenditure, we will have our risks, but how this government borrowing is being used, that matters a lot, and whether it is productively used or not. That will lead to economic growth or we will be in trouble. So the fiscal deficit basically defined as a good indicator that the difference between revenue receipts plus non-debt capital receipts, because non-debt capital receipts and total expenditure including loans net of repayment. It indicates the total borrowing requirements of the government. But how much you are basically borrowing? That is what is the deficit. So it is always discussed that whether the debt is sustainable or not. Actually, the debt is sustainable only if you are dropping and then give you loan. And if you have a debt, then you will doubt your debt and they will not provide you any kind of loan. Other countries may not, or other financial institutions, international financial institutions like IMF, World Bank, they may not be providing you loan the moment the trust on the economy is lost. So, able to receive loans again we want, and this is possible only when the debt that is taken is being used, and if you don't, and then for consumption purpose it may be okay, but then you need to open after they have donated the economy ଆମକୁ ଯୋଉ ଲୋନ୍ ନିଆଯାଉଛି ସେଥିରେ ଆମକୁ କେତେ ଜିନିଷ ମନେ ରଖିବାକୁ ପଡୁଛି ଯେ ଲୋନ୍ଟା ଆମର ଡେଟ୍ଟାକୁ ସଫିସିଏଣ୍ଟ ରଖୁଛି ନା ନାହିଁ ଆମର ଇକୋନୋମି ଉପରେ ଅନ୍ୟମାନଙ୍କର କେତେ ଟ୍ରଷ୍ଟ ରହୁଛି କେତେ ବିଶ୍ୱାସ ରହୁଛି ଆଉ ଆମେ ଯୋଉ ଲୋନ୍ ନେଉଛୁ ସେଟା ଆମର ପରବର୍ତ୍ତୀ ଜେନେରେସନକୁ ପରବର୍ତ୍ତୀ ପିଢ଼ିକୁ କେତେ ପରିମାଣରେ ଆମର ଡେଟ୍ ବର୍ଡନଟାକୁ ଟ୍ରାନ୍ସଫର କରିଦେଉଛି in the economy by talking about the deficits and debt. Now, if you look at today, we have around 70-75% Before this COVID started, the debt was almost 70%, close to 70% of our GDP. So it's huge, 70-80% is debt of spending. So because of like that, we may take a more loans also. So that means the debt burden is. So basically, the fiscal policy is a mix of budgetary instruments and my audible. It got disconnected again. Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
So the fiscal policy comprises of a mix of the budgetary instrument that the government use to target the economic objectives like your growth, stability, and the employment, or the issue of reducing unemployment. So it is the use of government spending and taxation to influence the major economic objectives like output, employment, and price stability. What is the major objective of a fiscal policy? The fiscal policy is the policy of the government related to its own expenditure and tax in order to influence the aggregate demand. And by influencing the aggregate demand, it is actually ensuring the growth in the economy. The government employs either, the government basically employs either expansionary fiscal policy or a contractionary fiscal policy, bringing stability in the economic system. So, it wants growth, it has an expansionary fiscal policy. What does that mean? Expansion, fiscal expansion can happen using fiscal instrument like taxation and competition check. So, expenditure. Now, during COVID, you may be seeing other that comments are the money to the economy through public expenditure, more and more. Money pumped into the economy by increasing the government expenditure or by reducing the taxes. When you are reducing the tax, the disposable income will go up. So this is expansionary. Similarly, the contractionary policy would mean that the tax is increased, that the tax rate is high, and the public expenditure is squeezed or reduced. So that is contractionary fiscal policy. The reduction in the government expenditure and rise in the tax rate would mean the government is following a contractionary fiscal policy. You don't so much government or expenditure to comment about government would contractionary fiscal policy. So the fundamental objective of fiscal policy in a developing economy is to achieve rapid economic growth along with a stable economy and a less and less unemployment. In doing so, government also looks at the objectives of distributive justice. Distributive justice means in a welfare state like India, the gap between the rich and the poor not be allowed to expand. মানে আমরা যে ধনী ও গরিব মধ্যে যে তারতম্য রয়েছে সেই তারতম্য যেতে যেতে কম হবো সেটা আমার পাই ইকোনমি পাই ভালো তো সেথিপাই गवर्नमेंट कौन करे इट इज गिविंग लॉट ऑफ सब्सिडीज दैट सब्सिडी मनी इज कमिंग फ्रॉम वेयर फ्रॉम रेवेन्यू दैट इज कमिंग अगेन थ्रू टैक्स टैक्सिंग द हेलो
यस सर,
हाँ
यस सर,
नंबर को क्लियर
हाँ सर,
प्रॉब्लम देयर इज सम इशू
सम
इन माय साइड
इंटरनेट
लाइक
इश्यू इज देयर सेथी पाई सर,
एक्सट्रीमली
अगेन एंड अगेन इंटरनेट डिसकनेक्ट. हाँ हाँ सर,
हाँ सो वी आर ऑलमोस्ट टू क्लोज ऑफ दिस थिंग्स सो देन आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट द डिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस हाउ टू एंश्योर दैट The gap between the haves and have-nots is as less as possible through the tax and transfer distribution system and all to the poorer section of the society. Now, economic stability is basically to handle the inflation and depression in the economy. This can also be handled using the fiscal policy like this tax and public expenditure. Suppose there is a deflation in the economy, the economy is going down, then there is a need to have more and more public expenditure so that public expenditure is a component in the aggregate demand in the form of G. Now, when this income of the people increases, now government spends money on constructing different buildings, machineries, and things like that. It gives money to the labor class and other construction sector and things like that. So as a result of that expenditure, people get income in their hand which they can spend, and it revives the economy through its multiplier effect. So public expenditure is to be increased to control the recessionary or deflationary situations in the economy. Similarly, reduction of tax helps in increasing expenditure and thereby reviving the economy. The reverse is true to control the inflation. In the case of inflation, government should reduce the spending and increase the tax rate so that your inflation is controlled. Government makes every possible effort to achieve full employment in the economy through effective fiscal measures, thereby increasing the government expenditure and reducing taxes, or by combining both. So a combination of both is also essential. However, though it is not a part, in reality, these two things, like your monetary policy and your fiscal policy, are basically like your dobi and tabla. So they have to be properly matched to produce a sound tuning for the entire economy. Otherwise, if there is no coordination between monetary policy and the fiscal policy, the way if there is no coordination gets spoiled, the entire economy can be spoiled if there is mismatch between the monetary policy and the fiscal policy. So the monetary authority, if there is any type of crowding out or so, has to accommodate. So the monetary policy has to be accommodating in order to ensure that there is no going out. Government is following expansionary fiscal policy. What happens? As a result of the expansionary fiscal policy, your rate of interest goes up. Where the rate of interest is going up, there is a crowding out of the private investment comes down. So the monetary authority, in the case of India, it is RBI, can accommodate this through expansion of money supply. Now, when the monetary authority expands the money supply, what is going to happen is the rate of interest will again come down and it can check the crowding out impact in the economy, thereby ensure that the economy is expected growth in the economy. So this is how this is what I was supposed to tell. There are some disturbance groups because of net. I am extremely sorry for that. And if you have any quick questions, I would be able to take it. Madam?
Dear learners, due to internet issues or connectivity issues, there are some interruptions. So if the learners are possessing any doubts regarding this topic, fiscal policy and tax system or deficits, then they may ask questions. This session was actually due to some technical, not technical, but it is some internet issues. That's why the resource person again and again was disconnected. So whatever things he explained about deficits, about expansionary and discretionary fiscal policy, or about the meaning of fiscal policy. So dear learners, you may ask questions in the chat box. Any query regarding this topic, can please ask question. A resource person has discussed about the federal tax structure that is prevalent in India, and the types of taxation, the types of taxes are prevalent in India. Then what are the objectives of legislative objective of fiscal responsibility and management act? And he has discussed very clearly in spite of this internet issue or disturbance about different types of deficits. Then he switched over to the fiscal policy, that what fiscal policy represents. And fiscal policy is nothing but it is the governmental actions through which the government maintain the income, state income, and control expenditure. It means fiscal policy dwara hi government action niye how to maintain mane गवर्नमेंट रो इनकम या पब्लिक इनकम जोटा कि आमे कहूचु पब्लिक रेवेन्यू एंड ऑल्सो अबाउट दी एक्सपेंडिचर एंड द रिसोर्स पर्सन इन अ वेरी क्लियर मैनर ऑल्सो एक्सप्लेन दैट व्हाट आर द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ फिस्कल पॉलिसी हाउ फिस्कल पॉलिसी प्लेज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट रोल टू मेंटेन द कंडीशन ऑफ फुल एम्प्लॉयमेंट इकोनॉमिक स्टेबिलिटी and to stabilize the rate of growth. So here economic stability it means to maintain full employment, to maintain the price stability, to maintain economic stability, to optimize the allocation of resources. So optimize allocation of resources, it means how to use the limited amount of resources in a best possible manner. And again, economic stability maintaining by full employment and price stability. Samaste janithibe je price stability mane kon? Price stability mane hoji to control the inflationary pressures in the economy. So inflationary pressures, jete bale inflation thai, well, the time of inflation problem or inflationary pressure, then the central government exercises discretionary fiscal policy. So ethi discretionary fiscal policy mane kon? Discretionary fiscal policy mane hoji ki इन्फ्लेशन को कंट्रोल करिबा पाई आउ और इन अदर वर्ड्स टू रिड्यूस द स्पेंडिंग्स टू रिड्यूस द स्पेंडिंग कैपेसिटी ऑफ द पीपल स्पेंडिंग कैपेसिटी ऑफ द इकोनॉमी हियर द गवर्नमेंट गोइंग टू एडजस्ट डेलिबरेटली एडजस्ट टैक्सेस और कट द स्पेंडिंग्स अकॉर्डिंगली सो हियर डेलिबरेटली एडजस्टेस टैक्सेस इट मीन्स व्हाट माने जदि इन्फ्लेशनरी प्रेशर होची इट मीन्स दैट कि स्पेंडिंग कैपेसिटी मनी सप्लाई इकोनॉमी रे बहुत थाए तो मनी सप्लाई टू कंट्रोल इन्फ्लेशन एटी कौन करा जाए गवर्नमेंट कौन करे टैक्स रेज करे सो दैट द स्पेंडिंग कैपेसिटी विल रिड्यूस बिकॉज द पीपल और द इंडिविजुअल हैव टू पे टैक्सेस सो दैट दे आर capacity to spend or their disposable income will reduced due to payment of taxation in this way the government control the inflationary pressure and maintain stability in the economy in the same way also a resource person has explained about the compensatory or the expansionary fiscal policy during the time of recession how the government adjust or how the government will maintain the economic stability by additional expenditure or reduced taxes will fill the gap so that the economy will maintain stability so in this way all these topics were discussed by our resource person so if any doubt regarding this topic then learners may ask questions in the chat box if they have any doubt then they ask questions regarding all these topics like deficits or tax system or expansionary or discretionary fiscal policy Asis sir, I think due to some interruptions or due to disturbances, some of the topics they are cleared best as your guidance, and some are not audible. That's why they are not. Maybe they may not be clear about that. But I hope that all the topics that you have explained in this session or today's session all are clearly clear to them, clear to the learners. So and from their side there is no questions so I think to close the session and for such a nice explanation about in spite of all these disturbances I would like to thank our resource person Asis sir thank you very much sir
thank you thank you very much. I could not help
no, no, no problem. That is beyond our control. So no issue. Due to some climatic problem and connectivity issue, there interruptions occur. So there is they all that are beyond our control. So once again, thank you, sir. And I also thank to the technical support team, those who are helping to make successful the session. And also I would like to thank all the learners who are present here and in spite of all these interruptions they have patience and they stay connected till the till end so again once again thank you to all of you thank you once again I think with this we should close the session Runita ma'am Runita ma'am
हाँ मैडम कौन
हाँ क्लोज करिबा
यस यस मैम
ओके ओके मैम थैंक यू मैम थैंक यू मैम
थैंक